are striving toward that. So
yes.
aspiring for that.
Yes. So true. Yeah. See, this is what, you know, totally different perspective. I mean, everything is nil. There is no need to have formal education to be an artist. Automatically, it goes away from that, you know, mind that who is true artist, you know.
So yeah.
That is so good. Fears go away, actually.
Yes, but at the same time, there is a value and necessity for that formal training of the...
Yeah. Have I missed you? Yes. Yes. There was some gap in between. I think... it's a time. Manishi?
Yes, ma'am. I'm ready, ma'am.
Wonderful. Oh, so after 1 minute, please, I request you to play Guru Vandana, and then we will, after Guru Vandana, I will introduce both of you, and then we'll start interaction. Right?
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
Manishi, we can play Guru Vandana now. It is 3:29, and we can start. Namaste, everyone. On behalf of Sri Aurobindo Integral Life Center, I, Kiran Singh, welcome you all. During this high period of modernism between 1910 and 1930, art cut itself loose from its social mooring and withdrew to save its creative essence. And to understand what is this creative essence, today we have with us Ms. Jayashree and Ms. Behlu Mehraji. Before we go ahead, I just give brief outline that what we are discussing in these sessions. The dehumanization of art that took place in early decades of the century was very much a response of the artist's spiritual discomfort in capitalist and totalitarian society alike. The early modernists turn inward, away from the world, to concentrate on the self and its inner self. If valid meaning could not no longer be found in the social world, they would seek it instead within themselves. And Sri Aurobindo also approved the idea by giving different perspective here. He said, I quote, art for art's sake, certainly. Art as a perfect form and discovery of beauty, but also art for the soul's sake, the spirit's sake, and the expression of all the soul the spirit wants to see through the medium of beauty. Quote, I unquote here. This can only happen when human consciousness begins to become aware of something within or beyond itself, whose nature is self-existent, peace and bliss. And when art leads to peaceful and blissful condition, healing automatically happens. So to get deeper insight on how art heals, refines, and transforms, we have with us Ms. Jayashree Ashok and Ms. Bailu Mehraji. Dr. Mehra was with us on 31st August to share her thoughts on role of art and beauty in vital education. She is a student of Sri Aurobindo with deep interest in this, in his social, educational, and cultural thought, and also writes on related topics. She has extensive teaching, research, and curriculum development experience in higher education and research institutes in the US and India as well. She is a senior academic mentor at Auro Bharati Pondicherry. Welcome once again, Dr. Mehra. I feel privileged to welcome Ms. Jayashree Ashok, who is the founder and director of Creative School and Pragya Living Wisdom Center, Bangalore, along with her husband Ashok and the founding team. She worked in the area of education with schools and NGOs for several decades. Ms. Jayashree's learning and inner growth led her to experience a deep spiritual transformation. She realized the need for a school that works with whole integral child. Thus, the creative school was born from this deep soul searching and healing undertaken by Jayashree and insights of her spiritual journey. Her journey led her to experience the teachings on integral education by Sri Aurobindo and the mother. Jayashree has created a model called the Sacred Classroom, which establishes the spiritual foundation and pedagogy of the creative school. It urges teachers to grow their own consciousness while working with the whole integral child. Teaching and parenting are treated as sadhana at creative school. It's my pleasure to invite Ms. Jayashree and Ms. Bailu Mehra for the interaction on how art heals, refines, and transforms through integral education. I invite both of you to start the interaction, please.
Thank you, Kiranji, for the kind introduction and your introductory words about the journey of, you know, sort of the movement in art world as it will in the last few decades. I think I'm just going to before we start with this interaction, I'm just going to kind of connect with a thought that we had explored last week, just so to sort of like build a bridge. One of the things we said in the last session was that one misconception or misunderstanding that many people have about vital education and why vital education, which is the education of the life or the emotional part of the being, why that is not often given its necessary significance, is that this misperception or misconception that many educationists even have, that whatever is the character of the individual, the nature of the individual, that cannot be changed, that one is born with a certain character trait, certain traits. There, the mother has given a very important insight into the human nature and the vital part of the being. And she says that this is a knowledge that has been there in all ancient traditions. Somehow this knowledge has sort of gotten disappeared over time, that whatever is the shadow in one's being, in one's vital part of the being, there is a potential of the same light also in the being. So it has been seen that if a person carries a certain kind of what we may see as a negative trait or as a dark trait, there is a corresponding positive light element in the same nature, in the same human individual. And this is where the role of education, especially the role of vital education, becomes very important when it is done consciously to bring the light part of the being more and more towards the surface. So the more the light, the more the positive aspect of that quality grows in the individual, grows in the child, the more the child or the individual, the adult, grows in consciousness. So this is where the vital education becomes very important. And as we were discussing last week about the role that art can play in refining the senses, in refining the perception, and certainly, you know, the mind being the largest, the biggest sense, you know, the sixth sense, as we call it, the manas in the Indian tradition, that becomes very important. So I'm very happy that we have this opportunity today to talk about some of the practical aspects of how art can become an instrument of that conscious preparation of the individual through a well-designed, meaningfully thought-out program of vital education. And in my observations and interactions with Jayashree Ji in the past, and you know, I've known about her work for some time now, I find that they have done a marvelous job of integrating arts and this idea of deeper, a seeking for deeper, truer beauty in throughout their learning process and curriculum in the school. So one of the first things that I think I feel that our audiences will really want to learn from Ms. Jayashree's experience at Creative School is the sacred curriculum that Kiranji, you also mentioned that she has designed as the foundation, the pedagogical foundation of Creative School. In what ways art and the seeking for beauty has been integrated into the sacred curriculum that is the foundational, you know, the basis of Creative School, and particularly the four-step learning process that I know that is sort of the at the heart of the sacred curriculum. So if you can sort of like start off with that, that will be really wonderful, Jayashree Ji. You need to unmute yourself. Yeah.
Am I audible? Is it okay? Okay, thank you. So the first thing I must mention is art is not integrated into the sacred curriculum. Art is the foundation of the sacred curriculum, in a way. Because when we talk of art, it's not only the fine arts, but like Beluji pointed out, it's the artistic nature of a human being that gets refined. It's the vital, as the vital being of a child or an adult keeps refining from within. Art and beauty become just very natural. So the sacred curriculum that we have implemented at Creative School has, first of all, it rests on the consciousness of the teacher growing, and the mother's words that teaching itself is a sadhana is very foundational for our work. So built on top of that, we have a beautiful learning process called four-step learning process, which addresses four aspects of the teaching learning process in the school. And through that, we have very consciously addressed, you know, working with the child in an integral manner. So the first part, you know, is quite common today, which is that learning by doing, experiential learning, joyful exploration. The second part, which is just the, you know, it's made all the difference to us, is what we call as reflection. So the first part is joyful exploration, reflection, rigor and mastery. And the fourth is wisdom. How do you develop physical, mental, vital, and the soul wisdom? And how do you use opportunities in teaching and learning to just develop the whole child? So the second step of the four-step learning process, which is reflection, is basically, see, in most schools, what happens, the teacher shares something and the child is doing something, but there is no pause taken to reflect and see how is the child learning this lesson? How is, what is happening inside the child in response to that lesson? What is the child's perception? Because a teacher may share something, but almost every child in the room perceives it in a way that they are ready for. So the reflection process in our learning process makes room for that. It gives children an opportunity to reflect back on what they're learning, whatever be the subject, whether it's language or science or arts or humanities or, you know, anything. There's a reflection process where the child is encouraged to reflect on what am I learning here? And they express that in many different ways. They express it sometimes through writing. They express it through illustration and art. They sometimes express it through arts in the form of crafts and using the visual medium, maybe sound. But all these different forms of expression, see, traditionally in schools, we have narrowed down expression to just literally vomiting out the lesson. Sorry, I'm a little blunt here and I need to be. Most schools think a lesson is learned when the child can vomit out exactly the answer that they are expected to. For the reflection process that we have in school is the exact opposite. Here we say, what are you learning out of it? And how can you express that in a way that is that you have internalized? And that process is where we integrate art into everything. We've integrated art in language teaching, in science teaching, in math teaching, in humanities, arts for arts, you know, just fine arts classes, of course, are very much there. And the last part that I really want to touch, because today's topic is on arts for healing, refinement, and transformation, is the number of opportunities that children have to express what is inside them. And over a period of time, their vital starts refining. They get more in touch with their own inner being. And the process of art itself can take them deeper into themselves, make them observe themselves more. And in that process, we have seen beautiful, deep healing and transformation, you know, through the growing years. And it becomes especially visible when children are adolescents. Yeah, so that's sort of a brief, I hope, maybe not so brief, a long summary of, I hope that response helped, Beluji. Yes.
Sorry. Do you want to share some examples, illustrations that you brought of how this, in the second step of the four-step learning process,
yes,
the reflection,
yes,
if you would like to?
Sure, I will do that. And let me just share the screen here. I have some pictures for you that I have put together. Let me just go to the actual learning process and how the reflection happens. Yeah, so art is a way of expressing what the child has learned in any subject, whether it's science, math, social studies, languages, because art is not separate from life. When a child learns in an integrated manner like this, with art as a foundation, you know, in today's modern world, there's a lot of conversation on the left brain and the right brain and how the left brain is logical and structured and the right brain is more intuitive and artistic. So when we do this kind of reflection, automatically we find that both parts of the child, the structured as well as the artistic part, remain intact. And even a very serious lesson, when the reflection happens through with art, gets beautifully absorbed by the right brain. So the children are encouraged to use art, painting, clay, along with text to express their learning. Okay, so let me go through a few slides here for you. This is in as early as second grade. So this is a wall of the children's stories in second grade, where the children have developed their own stories. They're just learning how to read and write, and they've developed their own stories with illustrations first. So we begin with illustrations. We don't just begin with text. And they've started with this, and By the time they come into older grades, I mean, you get such refined, their stories are fully illustrated. So this is throughout our language learning, whatever be the language, whether it's English or Hindi or Kannada, you know, illustration is very much a part of language learning. This is an example of social science learning, and this was a third grade project, third and fourth grade. They had gone on a trip to Hampi. As you all know, Hampi is beautiful. And this is a child's artwork to, I'll show you a group project that they did on Hampi. So this was the children's reflection. What stood out for me in Hampi? Somebody liked the Badami Caves, somebody else has mentioned something else. And this was made into a huge collage on the wall. And it was a group art project on learning, learning about Hampi. There's another beautiful one on, you know, the Rani Ki Vah well, step wells in Kutch, where the school had gone on a school trip and the children sat there and drew it and, you know, put it all together. So these are examples. In social sciences, it's wonderful. India's very rich heritage can be illustrated and drawn. And, you know, the children are, as you see, the artwork is, we let the child express according to their age. We don't correct and try to, you know, impose, because over the years it refines itself. And this is something that I want to bring up, that children's artwork just refines naturally as they're given more and more and more time for, it just comes from within. Yeah, and they are much better than me, I'll tell you that straight away. Another example of just art learning, you know, here they're learning about the moon and surface of the earth. Instead of just writing their answer in a notebook, you can see the children have created an art, and, you know, like how you do mind maps, each part of it has a representation of, and what a rich way of learning. You know, it's not just in a notebook with lines, but they're learning it with visuals as well. So these are some reflections on science. This is again a group project, and the children were given the freedom to express, you know, different colors. There are, you see different sections of children working on group projects like this. Of course, biology, botany, really lends itself to art, but it can be really beautiful and artistic, not just a sketch that we do, but something deeper than that. You can see more art reflections. We use art in physics and in everything. Everything is represented. This is another example of how the children, while learning a lesson in science, they have carved out these leaves where they have, you know, little notes about all the different parts that they're learning. So again, just look at the beauty of it versus just writing it down in the notebook. The whole process of creating these itself can make such a difference to the children. They really, I think what I have found is when art is integrated in their reflection, it just stays in them much longer. It's not just a rote memory, but it's something that is deeply you know, absorbed by them, no matter what the subject. Yeah. So I think that's sort of... where the reflection part is, Dr. Bilu.
So since we already have some of these slides up, maybe we can move on to the other part. I do have a question about the teachers that you mentioned.
Yes, yes.
But before we come to that, since we already are seeing this wonderful picture about the beautiful classroom setting, maybe if you can talk a little bit about the sacred classroom aspect of your pedagogical foundation and how you inculcate a sense of beauty and bring in the natural elements in the classroom context, the classroom setting, how you think that helps with the refinement part of the children's inner being. So what has been your observation and experience in that sense?
Okay. Thank you, Beluji. Yeah, so I can just share a little bit about our work. The sacred classroom is basically a foundation which is built for the growth of the teacher consciousness. So I will touch on your previous question as well, Beluji, and then lead into this. In our school, we begin with making space for the teacher's inner self-transformation. Like the mother says, I mean, very much, you know, those parts of us that are in the darkness can be transformed and we can bring divine light into it. So being a teacher is a beautiful opportunity for all of us to practice some of the higher qualities that we want to choose. And children also know exactly how to trigger us, how to annoy us, and they will poke out and, you know, show us all these areas that we need to transform and grow in. So this is the foundation, our school. The mother's words that teaching is a sadhana in itself is something that we have taken very seriously. So we have a lot of our teacher's training begins with our own transformation, making space for that. So transformation is not something that happens overnight, but week after week after week, you know, it's 12 years now. I know I've changed quite a lot from 12 years ago, and as have many of the teachers in our school. And we really look at ourselves. Where are we operating from? What are our inner impulses? Are we able to bring in that beauty, that sacredness? Here, the beauty we talk about is just sacred. I mean, you just look at this space. Sri Aurobindo's words that, you know, often the inner instruments of the child or the teacher, which is the calmness of the nerves, which is harmony in the classroom, those have to be intact before we can, you know, look at subject material. So we, in our sacred classrooms, is the foundation of our work to bring in that beauty in. And we just use the simple concept of Panchabhutas, which is so traditional in India, using earth, water, fire, air, and space. And we bring that in many different ways. And the best part is the classrooms are created by the teachers themselves. So it is the teacher's artistic expression. It's the teacher's time to have, you know, they look at their class and feel, my class is beautiful. You know, when you feel your class is beautiful, that is honestly a good 40, 50% of the job, because you are feeling good in your own classroom. When you do that, there's a certain harmony that comes into the classroom. So we spend our time, you know, really making our classroom spaces beautiful in a very whole way, like a temple. I think classrooms are temples of learning. So bringing in the five elements, and I can show you some pictures along this, beauty that is sacred. And when a child sits in a beautiful classroom, there is so much respect there, isn't there?
Mm-hmm.
Education needs to happen in beautiful spaces that are sacred. How can we put our children in drab classrooms, which are just boxes, which are dusty and have no aesthetic appeal? Because that's what they internalize. Children grow up in, you know, when they grow up in naturally sacred and beautiful environments, they internalize that. But when they grow up in spaces which you know, they don't care about how the classroom looks, that's what they internalize. Either way, they are internalizing. So the sacred environment brings in the elements, and automatically there's a higher prana, there's a higher energy in the room, and the learning happens so beautiful. And the teacher's innate creativity. So in our training programs, I have never told a teacher, you have to do it this way. We just bring in the elements and each teacher creates according to their own. And I must say that even, you know, we've worked with a lot of government school teachers. And oh my God, the government school teachers felt free. You know, they would bring sticks and stones and leaves and flowers and, you know, whatever is there in their neighborhood and create art forms. India is so rich. In just a small centerpiece in their classroom, it makes all the difference. It brings in that beautiful respect. So this becomes the foundation then for the children also to express. And that's how we've done this. I'll just show a few pictures here. Sometimes we do a small, we have this concept of opening ceremonies, which are also very beautiful to harmonize the class. And here you see two children. We have a small fire ceremony. We started with that and the children are safely passing on a diya, a lamp, to each other while, you know, saying something positive that just uplifts everyone. So you can see it's not that hard. It's just beautiful, simple. In fact, these are, you know, handmade clay pots that I think we picked up from Auroville. So you just see this as a, yeah. So these are just simple examples that I've shown. And again, I think art just flows into the classroom when we make space for beautiful classrooms. And you had asked about the teacher. Let me just go back and talk a little bit about our training of the teachers. So one of the things that we realized quite early on is with our teachers, I hope this is the right one here, is, you know, most times teaching is about what do you do with children? And poor teachers are given instructions. You need to do this and this and this and this. And, but if a teacher hasn't experienced this, if the teacher hasn't experienced art herself, if the teacher has not experienced the joy of creating, how can we pass that on to children? Something that we have not experienced ourselves. Like the mother says, a teacher teaches by who they are, not just through kind words, not just through words, but by who we are. So the very first thing we did was, you know, I want to acknowledge a wonderful art therapy teacher who came to our school, Dr. Cinta Gonzalez, and she helped us connect to what we call as intuitive art. Because art many times is very structured, you have to do it only this way. And she just said, art needs to begin from the inner being. So we did a lot of intuitive art, and the teachers experienced the freedom of just allowing art to come out from inside them. That made all the difference. That's what made it possible for us. So when you talk of a sacred classroom or you talk of sacred environment, that comes from a teacher's inner being. It's not just an externally arranged, you know, artistic, you know, arrangement, but it's something that comes. And for that, when a teacher experiences art, when the teacher has the freedom to create, that becomes the foundation of art that really refines.
You know, two thoughts come to my mind. One is that I'm just looking at this picture of teachers experiencing the artistic, the creative process. And I think all that has been said about teacher education and rethinking teacher education and new education policy. This one key component is missing. So I would request you and urge you, Jayashree ji, to really contact the right people at, in the right bodies who are looking at the implementation of new education policy. This idea of inculcating and developing a sense of artistic expression or an aesthetic sensibility in all those who work with young children or adolescents or higher education, that's very essential as part of the teacher preparation program. So, because like you said, you know, the inner being of the teachers has to be developed, has to evolve at that, to be able to actually see how it will work with children, with the learners. So it's very important. And the second thing, you know, looking at all those pictures of beautiful classroom settings, the bringing in of all the natural elements in classroom. Again, I think this is, again, we were discussing last week also, Kiranji, of how what Sri Aurobindo emphasized so much about how the mind gets influenced profoundly by what it sees and, you know, what the arrangement, the environment that is created for the learner, for the child, and also for the teachers, their workspace. It need not be expensive or, you know, designer or anything. It just need to be made that beautiful. So I think you folks are really doing a marvelous job there at Creative to bring that.
I think if I can pitch in here, Jayashree, you know, it's wonderful to see the work which you are doing is very inspiring. And with that, you know, number of questions also arises because the curriculum which you must have planned, or is it planned or not planned, and how the student of, you know, your school, manage the outer world when they go out, because outer world is very different than, you know, the environment which you are giving, because it is sacred environment itself, you know, where they themselves are inspired to do something. Teachers are inspired to do something. So how do they cope up with the other, you know, educational field? Because you have elder children also in your school.
Yeah. Actually, my answer may surprise you, Dr. Kiran. I'm going to say, in our experience, when a child is honored and respected as an integral being, something settles in them when they step out. And I'm going to ask this, how are children coping when they come out of schools that don't have this,
yeah,
right? Are they always coping well? I find that over a period of time, when children are given the space to reflect, the space to express who they are, and that refinement, and along with that, we have a very rigorous training of the vital, in the sense the children are asked to observe what is happening inside, what are your emotions, what are you feeling, what are the thoughts. So there's a lot of that self-awareness we build in. And when they go out, there is a certain, I don't know how to explain it other than saying a centeredness about them. They are grounded, and more importantly, they know what to say where. There's a wisdom that comes in, and I find that there is a certain, they're able to navigate, and sometimes they go through challenges and they, you know, reach out and ask, and then they come back and tell me, Jeshi auntie, we know now why you taught us what you did then. Because, you know, as they're growing up, it's like, you know, so much of it, they're asked to look within what is happening inside you. And, you know, children have come back and said, you know, I see my friends going and taking, you know, not always doing things that are not necessarily the best choice for themselves, choosing habits for themselves, just because they don't know how to acknowledge emotions, just because they don't know, they've had a fight with somebody, so they go and get drunk. I'm just giving an example. So I'm sorry, with all humility, I want to ask this. Why are we assuming that children coming out of mainstream schools know how to handle themselves? I must ask this question with the deepest sense of respect and humility, because it takes a lot. I think our education system needs to acknowledge the integral child. When we are sending them out into this war place that life has become outside, are we assuming that they are equipped? And how do we know that, you know, that they are equipped any better than children who've gone through an integral education where they've been honored completely, because they know how to take care of themselves? And that's self-awareness, that inner mindfulness, the capacity to handle themselves is, I don't know how we are creating more and more schools without an emphasis on this. So, due apologies if I've just been honest in my answer. Yeah.
I think this is a very normal question. It raises
on, yes, yes, yes,
mind of the mainstream, yes, educator.
Yes.
There are multiple questions, you know, on behalf of them, because I'm going through this journey, and it, yeah, is, it amazed me that, you know, why we are missing out this, you know, part. But with that, you know, it is very difficult to justify the way you, yes, are sitting here. Let's say, for example, you know, creating a secret classroom where teachers themselves are inspired to do, you know.
Yes.
So what is that, you know, what kind of environment you create there where they get inspired to do? Because ultimately, we all of us are basically, you know, studied in mainstream education system.
Yes.
Where we are trained to learn 9-to-5 job, or, you know, like if, even if you go beyond that, you know, there is certain responsibility duties which holds you back. But when you are inspired, nothing holds you back. So I want to understand what actually you are you're creating there.
So very simply following the mother's words, the teaching is a sadhana. Mm-hmm. So what happens is, what has made all the difference is, the teacher doesn't look at this as work. The teacher looks at this as their own self-development. I'm developing myself in the process of working with children. And that has made all the difference. So this is not about, see, as the person who has founded the school, all I can do is make space for the teacher to, for their own self-development. You know, we can say, okay, 9-to-5 is not just about going from class to class to class. It's important to look within. It's important to do that. But ultimately, it's each teacher's journey inside that framework. But what motivates the teachers is their own sense of inner growth. That today I'm refining myself more. Today I'm growing myself more. And the sadhana, we have a system in the sacred classroom where any challenge inside the classroom, we reflect and say, what inside us has created that challenge? What did we contribute to that? Of course, you know, children have their own. So that, then the teacher says, ah, okay, maybe I need to learn this. And, you know, then it becomes, I need to learn this so I can master myself. So the mother's guidance, like I said, that's our, you know, that's our foundation, that teaching in itself is a sadhana. I think that makes all the difference. And if the whole world were to think of work as, you know, the way the Gita says, which is, it is a sadhana, it's a dharma, right? And we are looking inside, then we have separated out the material and the integral world, and which is basically it. So it's not just inside the classroom, even inside the organization. Of course, you know, we are all adults working together. So we have challenges with, you know, sometimes in the workplace situation, we use that also for self-transformation. So anything that is difficult, we say, what did we contribute to it and how do we transform ourselves? And that's made all the difference. And just in case, you know, this is something that really touched my heart, so I want to share this. I'm going to, you know, combine it with Beluji's comment that we worked with about 400 government school teachers in Orissa, in Odisha. We just before the pandemic, we were, there was, you know, wonderful administrators who gave us an opportunity to work for 4 days with government school teachers who came from tribal areas, who came from Bhubaneswar and all over. And at the end of the 4 days, there was one thing that the teachers said. They said, all teacher trainings is about what do you do with the child. This is the first time we have received a training on how, what do we do with ourselves? How do we handle ourselves? And that need is there in humans. Once, you know, what Sri Aurobindo and the mother talk about, it's an innate need to just pause and look within, and that is there. It's just that we need to acknowledge it. And more today, I must say that more and more places are now understanding, you know, today there's this whole concept of mindfulness in the workplace, in the school. So looking within, becoming aware of our, you know, different reactions and noticing, bringing awareness is slowly growing in this world today. So I don't see creative as, I see creative as a space that gives children the tools to manage themselves. And many of our children have graduated and they are still using it. On that note, I just want to, you know, maybe take, since I've been talking a lot, I can show a couple of pictures maybe of things, you know, the lighter things that children learn as well. So this is one of the children's favorites. So I'll just bring this up. Just coloring mandalas. So some of our graduating children, when they face a difficult situation, they have been coloring mandalas from second grade, third grade. So they sit down and they just color. After some time, they start slowing down and they can hear this, you know, it declutters. Mandalas being circular patterns from nature, they allow you to become centered. So the children learn this all the way from, that's why I've shown different ones. You know, there are three-year-olds who do mandala coloring all the way through 13th grade. It's one universal art form. Of course, you know, the little ones have less complex ones and the older ones have more complex ones. See, these are all just the children coloring. Again, we do not insist on any colors they choose based on their own inner being. The difference between coloring a mandala versus, say, coloring Mickey Mouse, it's vast. Yeah, this is not just a coloring project, but it's a coloring project that refines and allows one to become centered. So a very valuable life skill. Any corporate, you have a rough day at work, sit and do some of this and you'll find a certain centering happening. Yeah. Another big favorite of ours is creation with flowers. We absolutely adore flowers. And the mother's teachings on flowers and flower consciousness is very alive in school. So pookalams are a traditional Kerala art form that's typically seen on Onam, but here, anytime and every time we can create. So these are some samples created by the children as group projects or individual ones. This is just, you know, the children were outside. I have a little story about the one on the mud. It was done by some boys who were feeling very, very boisterous. And, you know, there was this little, you know, they were just full of energy and they needed to have the right outlet. And the girls were like, oh God, these boys have, they're creating too much noise. So the two groups started, the boys used a huge coconut leaf and made mandalas, and the girls started arranging this. And within like 20 minutes, the class became more centered. Everything just sort of quietened down. And these are the magical moments for us. And I mean, how can we, not do this? You know, when as we grow up, we know that through art or through creating a small flower arrangement, I have the capacity to calm myself down. I have the capacity to slow down. So these are just some examples I wanted to share with you. Yeah.
Amazing. So, It's a kind of healing also happens, right?
Here. Yes, yes.
I would request Beluji to talk about a little bit how art heals. Because I have a book right now, in front of me, Sri Aurobindo's the book on integral healing. And it's amazing to read that how, art helps in psychological and even physiological helps in healing. So I would request Beluji to talk a little bit about it.
I can actually, first of all, let me just say how beautiful it is to just see these beautiful pictures and working with children, working with flowers and the mandala coloring. I can actually speak from my personal experience as well about how mandala coloring helped me many a times to calm myself down. And incidentally, when my own father was going through some very tough times, this is a few years back, one of the things that he was, you can call it prescribed or recommended by one of the doctors at the ashram, and he was with me and in those months, was to actually just sit down and do something beautiful, do something creative. So the kind of mandala coloring that I used, they are more elaborate, more complex patterns. But I found something much simpler for my father because his fingers were not working at that time. So how he would pick up colored pencils and, whenever he had those tough moments, I would see him go to that corner, take out his mandala coloring book, and start doing that. Even if he would do that for 5-10 minutes, it would help him, first of all, to get his fingers to start getting flexible. The other thing that I found, again, in his healing, because that was a very, very tough period for him, emotionally, psychologically, physically, on many levels. And the other thing that worked for him was to actually copy down some of the bhajans, the devotional songs that my mother used to write in her notebook. And she used to write just like, randomly here and there in the back of some diary. And my father, this was something that came out of his own sense. He thought, I need to organize all these for whatever little time I have left on the earth. So he took out all those scribblings, all those notes of my mother's diaries and started organizing them and writing them in his beautiful penmanship. Growing up, we had always seen, we always used to tell my dad that, you have such a beautiful handwriting. You should write more often just so because it's so beautiful to look at. So again, with his very limited mobility in his fingers because of this extreme arthritic situation, even if he would jot down from my mother's writings, few lines in this beautiful notebook, for him, it was a creative outlet. For him, it was a healing process. It was an emotional healing process, remembering my mother, remembering divine, because these were all devotional songs that my mother had collected from various places. So, I mean, I don't even have to talk about theory of how any artistic, any creative process can be healing. This is just something from my own experience, my own observation in the last few years that I saw major psychological transformation happened. I know that having interacted with Jayashree ji, in our school, in our educational contexts also, art can play a very important healing role, particularly when working with teenagers, because there are so many sensitive things that there are so many complex emotions that they are growing through, trying to understand their own growth process. So if Jayashree, you could speak a little bit about, in the educational context, in your observation, if you witnessed some of those healing moments, especially in the teenagers.
Yes, I can do that. Let me just give a very brief introduction to intuitive arts and then go into how that helps adolescents. So we have a lot of intuitive art therapy. By intuitive art, it just means that it's an open canvas for the child. It's completely child-driven, that allows the inner voice of the child to come out on paper. It's fully unstructured, free-flowing, and allows whatever is happening inside them to come out. And so what happens is, when a child is, you know, there are many art forms. Some of them are structured, and those have their own benefits. In intuitive art, we begin at a very young age, before I go into that, let me just go into the, okay, it looks like I've gone directly into the adolescent years. So there is no need for them to paint with any particular color or any particular structure. So after a while, especially when they're going through turbulent emotions, they start expressing whatever is there in any color that they want. Sometimes anger comes out in the form of art, and by the end of the intuitive art, they are done with it. So they have all of these things coming out. They churn out. They you can see them, you know, working vigorously on it. At the end of it, repressed emotions come out. Because sometimes with teenagers, they are a bit wary of, you know, we find up to about 6th and even 7th grade, children are very free. Okay, I feel like this or I feel like that. But as they come into adolescence, they're a little more guarded about, you know, being very open with everything that's happening inside them. So that's where the intuitive art really helps them. They do it through the art, and it gives them a way in which they can bring this out. This is also the time in today's world, adolescent children are really challenged with many different areas around body image, because beauty has become very, very externalized in today's world. And children, with their access to cell phones and the amount of media and all the emphasis being on bodybuilding and sculpting, you know, even at a much younger age, 5th and 6th grade, start showing, you know, they start becoming conscious that they are not, you know, looking like those people out there. And body therapy, what we do is, the children are given, you know, two children work with each other, and they just outline the body. And the children can then express whatever they want inside that outline. And this one exercise has really helped many a teenager come to terms with, who am I and what is my, that beauty is not just external. And they express many different things inside their, you know, their form. And honestly, sometimes our teenagers also go through all types of trauma. And even very deep traumas such as abuse can be healed through this process of the intuitive art body therapy. And it brings out their inner confidence, and most importantly, leaves them with a true sense of beauty. So this is one of the exercises we have. There are many different art therapy exercises. I just thought I'd give the sample. And like I said, working with teachers first is really necessary for this. And I wanted to say that this type of intuitive art actually starts in early childhood. It doesn't just begin with the adolescents. They're very free-flowing. And again, we do not, you know, make them conform. Like mandala art is very structured. You color inside the mandala. But in this form of intuitive art, it's unstructured and just allows it to come out. So art all the way from simple communicating to playing with colors to deeply transformational to even healing things like abuse, which are unspoken about. It comes out through the art, and the child is able to let it go and heal from it. So there's a whole range that can happen. Yeah.
This is marvelous. You know, I'm reminded of a statement by the mother that art is not skill, art is not talent, art is a living harmony, is a practice of living harmony. and through various methodologies or the various approaches to creating art, you are encouraging that sense of, finding that living harmony and coming back to sort of encourage children to keep coming back to that harmony. Because as Kiranji said, the outer world does come in, even when we are in a sacred environment like creative, or any specially consciously organized learning environment or work environment, the outer life does come in. So we keep going back from that a state of harmony to disharmony. So to have a set of like a toolkit to constantly keep referring back to those, that's wonderful. I wonder, Kiranji, if you can find out if there are any questions from any of the participants, or how are we doing with time?
So I just wanted to take a moment and just summarize, Kiranji's, your question, right? How do they deal with the outside world? I think what we do is give them a toolkit, like Beluji said, whether it's mandala coloring or intuitive art, or they learn, different forms of releasing negative emotions. So whatever they face out there, especially in their, before they graduate from school, there's a lot of strength training that they go through. They are challenged and, they learn how to make their way through those. And that's really what I meant when I said, how can we send them out into this world without any of this? It breaks my heart. Yeah. So many children and adolescents, and I live in Bangalore City where, the number of teenage suicides are going up. I think having, vital education, having education that gives children a toolkit on how to handle themselves is really the need of the hour. Like Beluji said, whether it's teachers or children, I think the government is going in that direction with the new education policy, and hopefully more and more. I mean, you're hearing of anger-free zones in school, and let's hope.
Yeah. That is one thing that if we have time, we could go into the Peace Corner concept at your school. But let me, before we do that, Kiranji, is there any?
I would, please, if you have any question, participants, I can see lots of participants are there. I've asked them to post it in chat box also. So by chance, if they have any question, please raise your hand, or you can write in chat box so, you can participate. And you trust me, this is not just discussion of art, but it is a discussion of education through art. And which is the foundation of our, Beluji and Jayashree, we subtly talked about vital education. It is a practical aspect of vital education. It's so, so important, which we miss out in our, regular education system. We don't bother about vital education much in regular education system. Only we focus on mind and mental. So I was reading, and that time I got to know that, art is for aesthetic sense. If somebody is teaching art, that is simply intellectual. That is what Sri Aurobindo talks about. But it is art or soul, we could see here through Jayashree's presentation. I don't see anybody has any question. It means, everybody's grasping what you are discussing here. Maybe, what we'll do, because after this session, lots of interaction happens here also at our university. And we, with the new faculty member and with the senior faculty member, we keep on discussing on how to bring this, four aspects of our education system of what Sri Aurobindo and the mother suggest. So we will again come back to you, Jayashree and Beluji, and we'll again discuss with lots of questions. But it's amazing experience which Jayashree, you brought in here. And when we see in real sense happening somewhere, there must be many questions. I have also many questions, though it is like, now I've absorbed, because I've come to Oro University, and I've observed that, how it enriches us, if we are not enriched from within, outside world, we cannot face. So actually you are giving strength to the students, in the beginning itself. So anything comes, it is easy for them to face. You are absolutely right when you were explaining that point where, I asked this question. I don't know, Beluji, if you have some, you know.
No, I think there was one thought that I had. If Jayashriji can speak a little bit about this wonderful concept they have at Creative. I know this because I have interacted with her in the past on peace corners and how that helps create that sense of inner beauty and inner harmony. You know, you talked about conflict in a workplace. There are conflicts between adults. How do you again inculcate a sense of striving towards harmony and walking out of the conflict in a positive sort of way? And how do you give that tool to the children? So if you can speak a little bit about this concept of peace corners in your classroom.
Okay. Thank you. This is one of my favorites. Every class in Creative School has a peace corner. It's a beautiful inviting space that anyone who is feeling the need to return to peace can go and spend some time in. And the peace corner is designed by the teachers and children in every class with age-appropriate tools. Let's start with the very little young ones. Yeah, 3-year-old, 4-year-olds, 5-year-olds. Often they're like bear cubs. They are, you know, playfully sometimes, you know, getting into trouble with each other. So then we just say, okay. And, you know, one is crying and the other is fallen down. And so it starts with as simple as, okay, let's go spend some time in the peace corner. When your body is calm, let's come back to the lesson. Let's come back to whatever you were doing. So we start with when your body is calm, or, you know, when you have fallen down and you're crying, just take, you know, the simplest breathing technique we have in school, which was taught by a teacher called Leonard Orr to us, is 20 breaths. So you're just taking 20 breaths to calm down. So children are encouraged, okay, if you've fallen down or you're upset about something, let's take a few deep breaths. Let's come back to the calmness in the body. So that's at the younger ages, because more than that, by the time they come into first and second grade, there are mandalas out there. So when they're upset or they're feeling a little out of it, then they come back and they color some mandalas or they read a book. And they just know that they can return to peace. That starts internalizing. The primary years is really where we want the children to internalize this concept that if I'm not feeling good, I know I can return to peace. And that happens in, you know, at the third and fourth grade, there may be a few more tools. In some cases, there's, you know, a pillow to hug, or there's some, basically the concept is that I'm going to take a little time to just come back to peace, come back into calmness. With the adolescents, the toolkit is more. At every age, the toolkits are age appropriate. So throughout the years, an adolescent knows that if they are, you know, as they call it, brain fried, those are the terms that adolescents use, right? I'm brain fried, or, you know, I'm all fogged up. So they know that they can do alternate nostril breathing and unfog their brains. I think the biggest concept that we keep bringing up in school is you're a conscious creator of your own life and you can take charge. If your vital needs calming, so be it. If your mind needs to be defogged, you can do that. That empowerment is what we teach. So the children have a choice. And of course, you know, when we find at home also that type of support is there, it lasts for the children for a long time. Wherever they go out, I mean, you have children who've gone, you know, outside the country as well, and they say, okay, I know I have my daily practice, so I know how to take care of it. There are a few cases where the parents are not really supportive of the children. In those cases, sometimes they really make it, and sometimes they can get a little stressed out. Yeah. So basically, the concept of Peace Corner, which it is just our dear wish that every home, every classroom, every workplace needs a Peace Corner. Just a place where you know you can return to peace. I think that's the simplest message we can give.
So incidentally, Sri Aurobindo used the term brain fog, I think, or mind fog when speaking of writer's block. So, you know, how writers are not able to come up with something. So your students are not that far off. They're using the right terminology. So I think, Dr. Kiran, I think we have covered the time, right?
Yeah, I think it is time. And Jayashriji, you talked about, you know, Peace Corner. It's an amazing concept, actually. And whenever you are fogged, actually you need some calmness and quietness, and then only you can come out. Yeah. However, you know, world keep on giving you advice. It does not work unless and until you try and you self-observe, then only it is possible. And actually it empowers throughout your life if you learn from childhood. Amazing experience, you know, amazing insight you have given. Both of you, it's so great to be part of this discussion with all of you. Thank you so much from bottom of my heart, you know, that you accepted our invitation and for sharing such valuable experience. I request participant in future, you know, please participate if you feel like, if you have any question, or you can post me later on also, so that I can pass on this question to both of them, and they will be, you know, I request both of you to, you know, reply me back so that, you know, yes, we can share your ideas with them. And the last thing which I want to announce, and I'm thankful to participant also for you know, staying so long for 1 hour with us to be part of this journey. Before we go away, I want to announce that we have another one more session, same topic, like art that transforms, on 16th September, and we have invited Gautam Ghoshalji, who is a professor of English literature in Shanti Niketan. Seeing you all of you here again, once again, on 16th of September, please. Thank you so much, Jayashree ji and Beluji. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.